Yo. So I just described Anupana and showed you some examples. For example, if you're taking oily stuff or if you drink oil, adjuvant that you can drink along with that is warm water. You don't want to drink regular water, you want to drink warm water because oil is sticky and heavy and warm water moves it down, whereas cold water hampers its movement. So anyway, water is the main one, and I already talked about this, how it's like nectar and it does all these things for you. And the best water is rainwater. And it's the purest form of water. And the second rains, not the first initial rain, but the later rain is better because the first rain clears the air and removes the impurities from the air, pollutants. And then when rain reaches the earth, its purity level changes because it takes on the properties and impurities that are wherever it falls. So like in the rivers, in the lakes and other places, it mixes in with the water and substance is already there. So spring water is a pure form after rainwater, but it's hard to find. Then the waterfalls, where there's no pollution, is also a natural and pure form of water. That's what I used to drink when I was out there on the road. Pure water is not available for everyone, so normal water can also be used after it has been treated, boiled, and cooled. Such water is also useful naturally as pure water, but boiling purifies the water and it makes it lighter. This makes it elevate the digestive fire. So it's good for the digestive fire and it becomes a good medium for digestion because it's lighter and it also acquires the ability to calm the doshas. So I already talked about there's a certain time, there's a certain quantity, and there's a certain method of water intake. Drinking too much water weakens digestion, and drinking too little water also messes up digestion and also causes a lot of toxic accumulation in the body, and there's a lack of urination and waste elimination, because which causes the accumulation of toxic waste in the body. And also it's important to drink little water at frequent intervals rather than a lot at one go. So slow and steady. This hydrates the body better and also increases the digestive strength. Water acts as a medicine during bouts of indigestion. So when you feel like you're not hungry and your stomach is kind of sluggish, and all you need is water to get you through that incident until your digestion gets better. Drinking water after the digestion of food lends strength to the body. Drinking water before eating weakens the digestive power and results in debility. So that's kind of interesting, the timing of water intake. So if you drink it before food, so there's a saying in Ayurveda, if you're overweight, then make sure to drink some water before you eat your food, like a half an hour before, because you shouldn't drink water along with food, they say. So a little bit before eating food, make sure to drink enough water if you're overweight. But if you're underweight, after eating, you can drink a little bit of water. All right, either before or after, depending on if you are too weak or too fat. So drinking water before eating weakens the digestive power and results in debility. A few sips of water taken between meals boosts digestion and increases the lifespan. Water taken an hour after meal strengthens the body and increases the body mass. So they say an hour, hour and a half after your meal, you should drink some water, a cup of water, because that's good for your digestion. Avoid drinking water at least half an hour before a meal. So you have to wait a half an hour before and an hour after before you drink any water. Unless in extreme conditions, I guess, in moderate amounts. And you should never drink room temperature water. You should drink warm water with your meals, because cold water changes the temperature. And too much water also dilutes the acids in your stomach and the food. So water intake immediately after a meal is harmful for obese and physically strong people. On the other hand, water taken between meals works as nectar. That means between meals, like hours between each other. One should consume buttermilk immediately after lunch. So you shouldn't drink water after lunch when you're thirsty. You should have other liquids, like buttermilk is a good one for lunchtime. So water intake is beneficial for everyone in all situations, but under certain conditions, its quantity should be reduced, such as anorexia, excessive salivation, diabetes, weak digestion, obstinate abdominal ailments like ascites, edema, kidney dysfunctioning, chronic cold, tuberculosis, eye ailments, skin diseases such as leprosy and wounds. So in these conditions, you should reduce your water intake. And it makes sense, like salivary conditions and kidney problems and so forth. Diabetes. No water intake also leads to various disorders. So I'm sure Western doctors don't tell diabetes patients, but when you understand the elements and how they cause the disease, then you understand diabetes is caused by water problems in the body. So no water intake also leads to various disorders. So the quantity of water is based on your circumstances, all right? So in vata and kapha, or gas and phlegm humors and disorders, and in obesity, warm water is beneficial. Whereas in bile aggravation, cold water is effective. So bile being the fiery element. In some conditions, warm or hot water is effective and beneficial. Whereas in others, cold water acts as nectar. Cold water is useful in indigestion and burning in the stomach because it soothes and strengthens digestion. But it is harmful in bronchial asthma, cold, and cough. So it's bad for the mucus conditions, but it's good for the acid conditions. It elevates the problem, okay, asthma and cough. So keeping this in mind, it becomes necessary to understand the qualities and effects of different types of water. So this is what this is the purpose I was talking about water, because there's a whole science in water. We learn about chemistry, but we don't learn about chemistry and how it relates to our body. And this is what these natural systems try to do, such as Ayurveda. So for example, they tell you not to drink water immediately after a meal. They tell you what cold water is good for. Oh, I really wanted to mention this too. So people who speak a lot, such as singers, speakers, teachers, or students who have to strain their vocal cords more than usual, should avoid drinking water after meals, as it washes off the essential oils taken in with the meal. So after a meal, you should not drink water if you speak a lot. And some people even gargle with oil and stuff if they're speakers. I'm sure there's some Ayurvedic techniques for that I could talk about later. But for today, I think that'll be enough. Now, they say you should not drink water after a meal because it's like you have a lot of food in there and your stomach is pumping acid and everything to digest the food. So when you throw in water on top of it, it tricks the system and it also makes it harder to digest. So that's why they say not to do that. But they do allow certain drinks like fruit juice and milk or and buttermilk at different times of the day at the meals. So if you have to drink water, they say to drink warm water. And another thing I wanted to show you was water. We already learned about what is pure and drinkable water. And we also learned about that the container it is put in does make a difference, because water is a very passive thing. It's like the male and female principle in nature. Water is a female principle. It's what takes in. It's what absorbs its environment, from its environment. And therefore, water, if you think about it, is a liquid that is supposed to have the highest surface tension of the known liquids. One of the highest surface tensions out there is water. That's why insects can float on top of water. That's why you can put a piece of paper and it'll float on top of water and not sink. It's because of the surface tension. So when you look at rainwater, when it rains naturally, or if it falls down from a cup, you'll see that it always coagulates. Oh man. You'll see it always tries to form like a circular shape. Even when it drops, it becomes like a spherical drop. So in India, they have these mud pots, small little pots that are like spherical shaped, and they carry the water. And people drink water and other drinks out of it. So it's kind of shaped like a wine glass without the a raised platform. So water naturally forms into a spherical circular shape, and if you keep your water in like a wine glass, it reduces the surface tension of the water in there because it's already formed like in its natural shape, which reduces the surface area, and therefore it has the least surface tension and a lot of volume in the same time. So yeah, that's another thing about water. So drinking warm water, drinking cold water has its benefits, and I'll talk about that in the next video. So this is some preview of hot water, different types of hot water and cold water and what they're good for. But hopefully you found that information useful and can think about looking into water and meditating on water and what power it has for your health and your overall vitality. All right then, take care, till next time.